Sure, I guess so, said Hendricks. I got nothing else going today, so I can sleep all afternoon. They drove out in Brody's late, she says. We'll see, said Brody. If they're really worried about this dame, they'll be awake. The door opened almost before Brody had finished knocking. We've been waiting to hear from you, said a young man. I'm Tom Cassidy. Did you find her? I'm Chief Brody. This is Officer Hendricks. No, Mr. Cassidy, we didn't find her. Can we come in? Oh, sure, sure. I'm sorry. Go on in the living room. It's in the top drawer over there. I looked. Brody paused for a moment, taking care with his words. Then said, Mr. Cassidy, I don't mean to sound flip or anything, but is this Miss Watkins got a habit of doing strange things? I mean, like taking off in the middle of the night or walking around naked? Not that I know of, said Cassidy, but I really don't know her too well. I see, said Brody. Then I guess we better go down to the beach again. You don't have to come. Hendricks and I can handle it. Beach. For as far as he could see, more than a mile in both directions, the beach was empty. Clumps of seaweed were the only dark spots on the white sand. Let's take a walk, he said. As he turned back and started walking again, Hendricks saw something ahead of him. A clump of weed and kelp that seemed Hendricks bent down to pull some of the weed away. Suddenly he stopped. For a few seconds he stared, frozen, rigid. He fumbled in his pants pocket for his whistle, put it to his lips, and tried to blow. Instead, he vomited, staggered back, and fell to his knees. Snarl, black spot on the sand, which he assumed was Hendricks. And then he heard the whistle more clearly. Come on, he said. And the two men began to trot along the sand. Hendricks was still on his knees when they got to him. He had stopped. You might as well look now, Mr. Cassidy. Tell me if it's her or not. Cassidy. That, he said, pointing at the weed. Reflexively, he stepped backward. That thing? What do you mean it's her? Brody was still fighting to control his stomach. Everything but cause of death when the phone rang. Unless you have any reason to suspect a murder, I'd have to say shark. Murder, said Brody. I'm not suggesting anything. All I mean is that it's conceivable, just barely. No suspect. Then it's a shark, and a big bastard, too. Even the screw on an ocean liner wouldn't have done this. It might have cut her in two, but... Okay, Carl, said Brody. Spare me the gore. My stomach's none too hot already. Sorry, Martin. Anyway, I'm gonna put down shark attack. I'd say that makes the most sense for you, too, unless there are, you know, other considerations. No, said Brody. Not this time. Thanks for calling, Carl. He hung up, typed shark attack in the cause of death space on the forms, and leaned back in his chair. The possibility that other considerations might be involved in this case hadn't occurred to Brody. Those considerations were the touchiest part of Brody's job, forcing him constantly to assess the best means of protecting the common weal without compromising either himself or the law. It was the beginning of the summer season, and Brody knew that on the success or failure